Hello and welcome to BYJU'S IAS, presenting to you the daily quiz for 23rd of July 2021. Let us begin and have a look at the first question for today. Pragyata guidelines issued by the Government of India refer to a set of guidelines issued for option A, protection of women at workplace, option B, provision of shelter, rehabilitation and care to children orphaned due to COVID-19, option C, promotion of traditional indigenous practices in agriculture, option D, planning and implementation of digital education. What is the context? This article in the PIB talks about the steps that the government has taken in ensuring access to education. It also has a mention of various initiatives such as the Diksha, which is the national teachers platform for school education, Swayam, which is an online education platform, etc. And this article also has a mention of the Pragyata guidelines. The COVID-19 pandemic has severely affected schools. In India alone, millions of students have faced the ill effects of this pandemic. For this particular reason, and in order to facilitate continued education through various modes and for a shift from conventional classroom teaching towards digital education, Pragyata guidelines were issued. So, Pragyata guidelines is an 8-step guide on digital and online education. It stands for plan, review, arrange, guide, talk, assign, track, and appreciate. So, what do the guidelines contain? These guidelines involve assessing the needs of the students, taking into account various different issues such as how much screen time and duration of classes should be held for each group of students based on their age, accessibility to technological aids, and to make education inclusive. It also talks about various interventions, the nature of content assessment that has to be included in the online classes. The guidelines also talk about the cybersecurity issues, as well as collaborations with various different initiatives that are already in place, such as Swayam. So, are these guidelines binding? No. These guidelines are only advisory in nature, and the state governments can formulate their own rules based on their local needs. So, let us now go back to the question. The right answer to this question would be option D, planning and implementation of digital education. Moving on to question number 2. Which of the given statements is or are incorrect? The 97th Constitutional Amendment Act dealt with the issues related to effective management of cooperative societies in the country. The Parliament alone can enact laws with regard to cooperative societies, including multi-state cooperative societies. The subject cooperative societies falls in the concurrent list. What is the context? The Supreme Court has upheld the validity of the 97th Constitutional Amendment, but it has struck down a part of this amendment. The Supreme Court held that Part 9B has significantly and substantially impacted the exclusive legislative powers of the state legislatures over the cooperative sector. So, what has the Supreme Court done? It has struck down a part of this 97th Constitutional Amendment, which shrank the exclusive authority of states over its cooperative societies. So, now it has said that the states alone have legislative powers over cooperative societies. Let us go back to the question and answer it. The 97th Constitutional Amendment Act was passed by the Parliament in the year 2011 and it came into effect in the year 2012. This dealt with the issues related to effective management of cooperative societies. So, what did the amendment do? It made the right to freedom to form cooperative societies a fundamental right under Article 19, Clause 1, Clause C. It also added Article 43B as a DPSP and inserted Part 9B. So, statement number 1 is correct. Now, after the latest judgment, Part 9B of the Constitution of India is operative only with respect to multi-state cooperative societies. But when it comes to the matter of cooperative societies, only the states can enact laws. The Parliament cannot enact laws with regard to cooperative societies as it is a state subject, making statement number 2 as well as statement number 3 incorrect because cooperative societies falls in the state list. Therefore, the right answer to this question would be option B, 2 and 3 only, as the question is asking us for incorrect statements. Moving on to question number 3. which of the given statements is or are correct. Statement number one, as money supply in the economy falls, the interest rate also has the tendency to fall. Statement number two, an expansionary monetary policy is implemented by lowering the key interest rates. Statement number three, the policy interest rate required to achieve the inflation target is decided by the Reserve Bank of India. Why this question? This article in the Hindu newspaper talks about inflation situation in India. It is in this context that we've taken this question. The former World Bank chief economist Kaushik Basu has called for coordination between RBI and the government to deal with the inflationary situation, considering the fact that India's wholesale price-based inflation is at a 30-year high. Coming back to the question, so the control of money supply helps to manage inflation or deflation. The mechanism through which the central bank controls inflation depends on the interest rate. Remember that the interest rate and money supply move in opposite directions. Therefore, as the money supply in the economy falls, the interest rate has a tendency to rise. And vice versa, that is when the money supply in the economy increases, the interest rate falls. Therefore, statement number one becomes incorrect. Moving on to statement number two. In managing the inflation, the monetary policy can be expansionary or contractionary. What happens in an expansionary monetary policy is that it is focused on increasing the money supply in the economy. So how is it done? It is done by lowering the key interest rates in the economy, which in turn increases the liquidity in the market. Therefore, statement number two is correct. Statement number three is incorrect because in India, we follow inflation targeting. And we've discussed this before. The policy interest rate required to achieve this inflation target is decided by the Monetary Policy Committee and not the Reserve Bank of India. Please note that the RBI is not synonymous with Monetary Policy Committee, and it is such statements that can create a confusion. Therefore, the right answer to this question would be option A, 2 only. Coming to question number 4. The Democracy Index is published by option A, World Bank, option B, Reporters Without Borders, option C, Economist Intelligence Unit, option D, Varieties of Democracy Institute. Why this question? This article in the Indian Express newspaper talks about how the spyware Pegasus is a matter of grave concern for Indian democracy. And the article also has a mention of the Democracy Index. The annual Democracy Index is published by Economist Intelligence Unit. EIU is a research division of the Economist Group, which is a UK-based private company. This index intends to measure the state of democracy in 165 countries and 2 territories. The scores are calculated based on 60 indicators which are grouped into 5 different categories, that is, electoral process and pluralism, civil liberties, functioning of government, political participation and political culture. So the countries are scored on a scale of 10 and then they are placed into one of these 4 categories based on their scores. Coming to India's ranking, India is categorized as a flawed democracy in the 2020 index. India's score was 6.61 in 2020 on a scale of 10. The highest that India has scored was in the year 2014 at 7.92. So India's ranking on democracy index is 53 in the 2020 index, which is 2 spots lower than 51 that it was in the year 2019. So we know the answer to this question. It would be the Democracy Index is published by Economist Intelligence Unit. Now let us take up a previous year question from Prelims paper 2018. Consider the following pairs of terms sometimes seen in news versus context or topic. Number 1. Belle II experiment, artificial intelligence, blockchain technology, digital or cryptocurrency, CRISPR-Cas9, particle physics. Which of the pairs given above is or are correctly matched? The Belle II experiment was a particle physics experiment. It was carried out in Japan to study the properties of something called as B-mesons. Therefore, it is not related to artificial intelligence, making one incorrect. Digital or cryptocurrency, as we all know, is based on blockchain technology, making two correct. Number 3, CRISPR-Cas9 is a genome editing tool. So this could allow the scientists to edit genomes with precision and could transform the field of biology. Therefore, it is not in the field of particle physics. Therefore, the right answer to this question would be option B, 2 only. Now let us take up the fact of the day, central bank digital currency. What is the context? It is likely that the Reserve Bank of India will soon start off a project to evaluate the feasibility of digital currency in both wholesale and retail payments. This project would be carried out so that it can formulate a strategy for introducing a full-scale central bank digital currency. So, what is this central bank digital currency? It will be a legal tender just like our currency and would be the liability of the nation's central bank, but in digital form. So, a CBDC uses an electronic record or digital token to represent the virtual form of fiat currency. So, this would be centralized and would be issued and regulated by a competent authority or the central bank. The retail CBDCs would be for individuals, households and corporations, whereas wholesale CBDCs would be meant for the use by financial institutions. So, why does RBI want to explore this particular option? We know that the digital currencies or cryptocurrencies are quickly becoming popular. This has made most central banks to look at the option of launching a digital currency themselves, a digital currency that they can control so that the concerns associated with such cryptocurrencies can be addressed. And also, this would help facilitate the shift towards a cashless society. Earlier, a high-level interministerial committee set up by the Finance Ministry to look into the option of CBDCs had recommended its introduction. This committee had also called for changes in the legal framework, including the RBI Act. Currently, RBI Act empowers RBI to regulate issuance of banknotes. So, before introducing such government-backed digital currency, RBI should see if it can leverage on the technology and issue fiat money in digital form or not. It has to check the feasibility of this central bank digital currency. So, what could be the potential benefits of CBDC? With the introduction of this digital currency backed by the central bank, money transfers and payments can be made in real time. Number 2, the central bank would be able to keep a track of the exact location of every unit of currency, so tracking of currency will become easier. This will also help in curbing criminal activities, money laundering, etc. So, when currency can be easily tracked, it will also help in checking tax evasion. Another benefit of the digital currency would be it would help in reducing the cost of currency management. How? The cost of printing, transporting and storing paper currency can be substantially reduced with the introduction of digital currency. They could also enable a cheaper and more real-time globalization of payment systems. So, these are the benefits. On the other hand, there could be certain challenges involved in the introduction of central bank digital currency. That is, widespread adoption of this form of digital currency might be difficult because of barriers such as data privacy, lack of digital knowledge, and also access to information technology. Also, defending against cyber attacks will become more difficult and challenging. And in terms of cross-border payments that we discussed, that is the globalization of payment systems, legal and regulatory framework for each and every country would be different, and this could pose a significant challenge. So what RBI will do is first conduct a feasibility study on the development of such a government-backed digital currency, that is the central bank digital currency. So you might ask, what is the difference between cryptocurrency and CBDC? The major difference is that while cryptocurrency approach focuses on democratizing financial systems, CBDC focuses on centralizing the financial systems as it would have to go through banking system. That is all for today. Thank you for being with us. Keep watching and keep learning.